Good morning and welcome. This is the joint service of Peace Lutheran Church of Pico Rivera and St. John's Lutheran Church of Long Beach. We welcome you to our service. Today is the 17th Sunday of Pentecost. We're thankful to God that you are here to worship with us this morning. Your presence is truly a gift from God. May He bless our worship time together. I am Pastor Mike Grobelch, and I will be leading these services this morning. If you would like to receive copies of the bulletin and sermon prior to our service, please email us at the following address: Peace, P-E-A-C-E, L-U-T-H-C-H, @gmail.com. Or you can DM me at either one of our Facebook pages, Peace Lutheran Church and St. John Lutheran Church. You may also request information by mailing us. Our mailing address is 9412 Shade Lane, Pico Rivera, California, 90660. You may also send in prayer requests the same way. Please join in the responsive readings during the course of this service. We begin our service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and I sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Almighty God, in His mercy, has given His Son to die for you, and for His sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you make the minds of your faithful to be of one will. Grant that we may love what you have commanded and desire what you promised, that among the many changes of this world, our hearts may be fixed where true joys are found. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament lesson comes from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 18, beginning in verse 1. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you mean by repeating this proverb concerning the land of Israel? The fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As I live, declares the Lord God, this proverb shall no more be used by you in Israel. Behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the Father, as well as the soul of the Son, is mine. The soul who sins shall die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. Hear now, O house of Israel. Is my way not just? Is it not your ways that are not just? When a righteous person turns away from his righteousness and does injustice, he shall die for it. For the injustice that he has done, he shall die. Again, when a wicked person turns away from the wickedness he has committed and does what is just and right, he shall save his life, because he considered and turned away from all transgressions that he had committed. He shall truly live. He shall not die. Yet the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord is not just. O house of Israel, are my ways not just? Is it not just your ways that are not just? Therefore, I will judge you, O house of Israel. Everyone according to his ways, declares the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions, lest iniquity be in your ruin. Cast away from all your transgressions that you have committed, and make yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, O house of Israel? For I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the Lord God. So turn and live. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle lesson for today comes from the book of Philippians, chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affliction in sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Do all things without grumbling or questioning, that you may be blameless and innocent children of God, without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. Even if I am to be poured out as a drink offering upon the sacrificial offering of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. Likewise, you should also be glad and rejoice with me. This is the word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter. And when he entered the temple, the chief priest and the elders of the people came up to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus answered them, "I also will ask you one question, and if you tell me the answer, then I also will tell you by what authority I do these things. The baptism of John, from where did it come? From heaven or from man?" And they discussed it among themselves, saying, "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' If we say, 'But from man,' we are afraid of the crowd, for they hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things." This is the gospel of the Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and redeemer. If you're into sports or like playing games, or in any type of competition, there are winners and there are losers. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. And there's an old saying that goes, "It doesn't matter whether you win or lose, it's all about how you play the game." Growing up, I hated that saying because I hated to lose. I preferred what the legendary football coach Vince Lombardi said. He said, "Winning isn't everything, it's the only thing." To that end, when I wanted to play a game, I wanted to change the rules, to stack the deck in my favor. I wanted every advantage I could gain for myself. I wanted to give myself the best shot at winning against a better opponent, who usually defeated me anyhow. It's just I wanted to win, but I didn't want to break the rules, just to change them, and it rarely ever worked. In our text, God is changing things a little bit, changing what he wants from Ezekiel to preach to the people. In those days, there was a proverb quoted in our text, "The fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge." This was something the people would say if they wanted to claim they were being treated unfairly, supposedly having to pay for someone else's misdeeds. The children would pay for the sins of the fathers, and the children often did not repent of their own sins, making the punishment worse. They wanted to pass the buck, if they could, to let somebody else bear the brunt of the punishment they richly deserved. But they were to repent of their sins and their sins of their forefathers, which were passed down to them. In fact, God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. God said to him and to the Israelites, "I am the Lord your God. I am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments." But God, in his mercy, relented from that particular decree. He would no longer demand his people pay for the sins of their fathers. From now on, they were accountable for their own sins and no one else's. In fact, the Lord commanded two of his prophets, Ezekiel, who we read about in our text, and Jeremiah, to no longer speak of this proverb. It no longer applied to God's people. They were to confess their own sins. They were to repent of their own sins. They were to turn from their sins. That's the word that what repent means, to turn away from. This is God's call to us as well. God wants us to repent of our sins, to turn our backs on them. Turn toward the God who gives us the command, repent and cast away. Make a new heart and a new spirit. Turn and live. What God asks of us is pretty simple, really. Repent, turn, and live. God wants us to live because he does not want anyone to die in their sins and thus be eternally condemned. He does not desire death of the sinner. God wants us to turn from our sinful ways so that we would live with him in heaven forever. The Apostle Paul offers us encouragement in our epistle. "Do all things without grumbling or questioning, that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain." But we will live as people who lack encouragement, people who need to be lifted up from this veil of tears, this valley of sorrow in which we live. We live in a world that is filled with sin, the sin of the devil, the world, and our own sinful nature. We live in a world that surrounds us in sin, and we add to that sin that surrounds us. When we confess our sins at the beginning of the service every morning, we did not confess the sins of Adam and Eve, our first parents. We did not confess the sins of our parents or our grandparents. We even did not confess the sins of our brothers and sisters or even of our own children. We said, "We confess we are by nature sinful and clean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment." Our confession of sins is not to confess someone else's sins, just our own. Just as we cannot confess the faith for someone else, we cannot confess the sins of someone else. We alone are responsible for what we do, think, and say, and what we don't do. God has made this abundantly clear when he wrote his law on our hearts. To break God's law is to sin. To sin is to act apart from the faith his Holy Spirit has sought to work in us, to act in unbelief. When we sin, we are not turning away from our sins, but we are turning ever closer to them, and we turn even further away from God. We like to toss and turn and wallow in our sin. We do not like to repent. We do not like to confess our sins. We do not like to turn from our sins. But in our sinful nature, we will die eternally in our sins, and we will have no one to blame but ourselves for our own condemnation. However, St. Paul reminds us in Romans chapter 8, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That means because we are in Christ Jesus, we need not fear death, for we will live forever in heaven with him. Jesus has made this our new reality. It is our reality every time that God forgives our sins for Jesus' sake. You see, we can't turn our backs on our sins. We can't do anything to save ourselves. This is true of you and me, as well as our parents, and going all the way back to the Garden of Eden. Even when there is a paradise that Adam and Eve lost, God promised them an even greater paradise. The same paradise the crucified Lord gave to the criminal hanging next to him on Good Friday. God promised Adam and Eve a savior, their own flesh and blood, as St. Luke notes in his genealogy of Christ. This savior of the nations came, David's son and David's Lord, in the person of Jesus Christ, true man and true God, who came into this world to be crucified for the forgiveness of our sins. Because we are unable to turn our backs on sin, Jesus turned his face toward Jerusalem to go the way we could not go, the way of the cross. Jesus spoke through Ezekiel, using the people's words against them. They said, "The way of the Lord is not just." And this is true in one sense. True justice, absolutely true justice, would mean that we would die in condemnation for our sins. In one of the great Lenten and Holy Week hymns that we sing, the images of injustice rings true on our ears. Tell me, ye who hear him groaning, who was there ever grief like his? Friends through fear, his cause disowning, foes insulting his distress. Many hands were raised to wound him, none would intervene to save. But the deepest stroke that pierced him was the stroke that justice gave. Jesus received our justice for us because we couldn't turn our backs on our sins by ourselves. God the Father turned his back on his only begotten Son so he wouldn't turn his back on us. And thanks be to God, this is true. For our sake, God made himself to be sin who knew no sin, that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That is why we confessed our own sins this morning. We asked God to forgive us. We prayed for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. What do you then hear after that? You heard me say under the orders from God to forgive you all of your sins. Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for you and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. Everything that happened here in the divine service is done for you, done for Jesus' sake. For what God gives you cost Jesus his very life. He gave his body on the cross and shed his blood from the cross. The very body and blood he gives us in his supper. Given and shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. All of your sins. The gifts are for you, freely given by God, that you would live with him in heaven forever. It is only by faith that we accept these gifts, for it is by faith alone that desires these gifts. Faith alone craves the forgiveness Jesus won on the cross and gives you in baptism. Absolution, the Word, and the Lord's Supper. This faith is not of our own doing, but it is a gift from God as well. For the Father and the Son have sent the Holy Spirit into our hearts to work in us this saving faith in Jesus Christ, the Christ who bled and died on the cross, the Christ who rose from the dead on the third day, the same Christ who ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, the same Christ who descends to us in his means of grace to give you what he won on the cross for you. The Holy Spirit moves us to repent of our sins, to turn our backs on them, so that we will be renewed, restored, and forgiven. He continues this good work in us and will bring it into completion into the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit turns us away from our sins and towards the one who set his face towards Jerusalem, so that his Father would turn his back on his Son for our sake, and will, in the benediction, he will turn his face towards you, look upon you with favor, and give you his peace, the peace that surpasses all understanding, the peace that the world cannot give. God the Father turns his face to you, and the Holy Spirit turns you back towards Christ, for he leads you to repent, turn, and live. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us confess our common faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. We confess, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now let's take a moment for prayer. Almighty God, you have blessed us in love with the Savior, to whom the nations cry, and in whom there is forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. Grant to us your Holy Spirit, the Comforter, whom you have promised, that we and all who call upon his name shall be saved. Help us to treasure in our hearts your mercy, and to give ourselves fully to your service. Lord, in your mercy, Almighty God, you delivered your word through Moses and the prophets and fulfilled your word in Christ. He was planted in death for our sins and raised for our justification. And in him shall all the nations of the earth be united. Give us pastors who will preach this word faithfully and church workers who are devoted to your service. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you have promised the thirsty will drink, and from the empty will flow forth of rivers of living water. Help us to show forth in our holy lives the fruits of the Spirit and to live with love toward our neighbor. Give us a servant's heart that does not seek our own way, but walks on the path of eternal life. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you have promised to make one people from many. Take from us all pride, prejudice, and hate, that we may not hinder the cause of the gospel by our shame, but give welcome to all peoples in the name of Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you have all ordered all things and in heaven and on earth. Bless Donald, our president, Gavin, our governor, the Congress of the United States, and all elected and appointed civil servants, that the rule of law may protect the weak, preserve life from conception to its natural end, and peace may reign for the benefit of all. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, have mercy on us and spare us. Put an end to the pandemic and restore the communities of the world to their common life. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you have given our nation the gift of and heritage of freedom. It came at the cost of many lives on battlefields far and near. Receive our thanks for their sacrifice and give us the courage to preserve liberty in our own time and to use it honorably. Preserve and protect those who continue to serve us in the military, law enforcement, and as first responders. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you breathe hope into the weary and renew your church by your grace. Bless newly planted congregations that they may endure. Guide established congregations that they may not lose heart. And build up our synod with the zeal for your kingdom that may not flag but flourish and prosper according to your will. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, your word endures forever. Give us grace so that we may be united in doctrine and in fellowship of your table, confessing Christ boldly and living together in faith and love until our Lord returns in his glory to bring all things to their appointed completion when we will dwell in his house forever. Lord, in your mercy. Our gracious and heavenly Father, we cry out to you for mercy during these difficult days. Please, O God, heal our land. Bring peace to our neighborhoods and cities, and tear down the walls of hate and injustice that divide us. Raise up your church to be a life-giving force, ambassadors of reconciliation. Empower us for action that we will do more than talk, for it is time to act. May we be a model for our world, the oneness in Christ, who alone is the hope of the world. Give wisdom to our civil authorities and faith leaders to make decisions and lead in directions that will result in repentance, healing, forgiveness, new directions, and peace. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, remember us in your kingdom as you teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Go in peace and serve the Lord. I'd like to thank the following people who made this taping possible. Our directors of music, Katja Richardson and Roy Selden, and our ASL interpreter, Maria Coronado. May God's perfect peace be with you this week and always. Please help us to share the word, hit like, subscribe, and share this video. If you're in Pico Rivera or North Long Beach, our services at Peace are at 9 a.m. We also have an 11 o'clock service, which is in Spanish. And our service at St. John's is at 12:30 p.m. If you're in the area, we encourage you to join us. Thank you for being with us this morning, and we pray God's richest blessings on you.